So a very good afternoon to all the participants of this webinar on case laws. And we are starting discussion on 1st of February at 3 p.m. on the case laws of the cases that have been decided by the Supreme Court and the High Courts recently. More appropriately, in the past 3 years or so. So let us start looking at the case laws. I've shared my screen with you. And so, first of all, to begin with, I'll just show you certain cases that have been recently decided. Now there is one CIT versus Vatika Township. This is a case that has been recently decided, and it deals with interpretation of statute, specifically about section 113 and the proviso which is inserted by Finance Act 2002. There is a very, very important judgment of the Supreme Court, which is called the State of Uttar Pradesh versus Sudhir Kumar Singh. And all those who have been interested in knowing about natural justice are strongly recommended to read through this entire judgment of the Supreme Court, which is recently passed in 2020 itself. So this judgment brings out various elements of natural justice, and we'll just try to see what this judgment mainly talks about. We are also strongly recommending to you to read Mr. Kalyan Nath, additional CIT's article in the Taxalog e-journal on penny stock cases. On penny stock, we have had judgments like Suman Potar judgment, which has been a very, very important judgment. And as you are aware that in case of penny stocks, the department has had a huge success in nailing down the matter to a substantial degree due to the efforts made by some of our finest officers. In relation to the penny stock, a recent judgment is the Krishna Devi and others judgment. So we would need to look into this judgment also, which clarifies a number of issues. Then, of course, there is an important judgment of NK proteins. Sir was referring to this judgment in the morning also. And primarily, this judgment submits that once it is proved that the purchases are bogus, then entire purchase should be added, and not the profit element which is embedded in such purchases. So this judgment creates a pathway to add the entire purchases. But how that is to be done and in what circumstances, that is something for which the judgment needs to be read in toto. Otherwise, we may lead to a wrong conclusion. Okay. Having said that, let me take you through a few judgments. And before that, before I go on to read through a few judgments for you, I would like to show you and very strongly recommend to you that some of you who are not already using NJRS for them, that NJRS is a very, very, very important portal from where we get our judgments. And let me also clarify to you that I've been also able to get a lot of judgments from NJRS for you. So I'll just show you initially how to access the judgments in NJRS. Because in case you are not having the password for NJRS, please get that. And all you have to do is type NJRS on the top bar and Google search for it. As you Google search for NJRS, the first link would be of NJRS itself, the National Judicial Reference System, and this is the first page of that National Judicial Reference System. So to log into this, you have to press ITD login, and when you press ITD login, you will be presented with a login screen, just like this one, where you have to put your user ID along with you, as it is, you can see here, as it has been put here, and your password and this four-digit number. So this four-digit number has to be also entered. And when you enter it, you have to press login. So when you press login, you are taken to this initial screen. From here, you just go proceed. And then you are presented with the first screen of the inside of the NJRS. Of course, some reading material has been put on the front page, which you can at any time download, like there's some letter share volumes, and of course the administrative manual and the decision kit for departmental officers. So how to go about searching for a case here? First thing that you have to do is that you can be rest assured that almost every judgment that you are having here, it will have somewhere tax written there. So just type tax. And here you have a selection of judgment, appeal, and Income Tax India. So just select judgment and then click the find button. So as you click the find button, it finds all the judgments. And it has found here 3,15,263 judgments, which has the word tax written in them somewhere or the other. Now, these judgments are ordered by the order date. That means this is a recent judgment. As you can see, the first judgment is of the ITAT Patna, and it was issued on date 18 December. So reasonable degree of updation is taking place in NJRS. And in case you want to filter the number of cases, you can go by, let's say, the court. If you want to select just one court, that also will do. If you want to select just circular or instruction, because even circulars and instructions have been uploaded there, you can go by that. For our convenience, if we select Supreme Court only, as you can see, there are 6,912 Supreme Court judgments here. I will not be going into the full detail of NJRS because that would be a thing of NJRS lecture, but just to give you a small idea. And then we can even filter on whether it is against the SSC, in favor of the SSC, or in favor of the revenue. So let's say I've selected favor of assessee, favor of revenue, so that I can get those judgments which have some clear-cut decision there. I press the button apply filters, and having pressed this button apply filters, the filtered judgments are now selected. So as you see, 5,651 judgments are now selected. Now within these judgments, if you want to narrow down your search, you can search within these judgments by typing anything here in the narrow search. Now we have been given here a list of 5,651 Supreme Court judgments, and we can open them up and read them at our convenience. So for example, but I'd like to suggest to you that most of these judgments are one page judgments where some order has been rejected or something like that, or some application for delay has not been considered, or a review has been rejected. But wherever there is some substantial thing in the judgment, you will find that there is some comment over here or a summary. So wherever there is a summary, that means that there is something has been decided in that judgment. So for example, the judgment has been passed on 11/9/2020 in the case of National Cooperative Development Corporation versus Commissioner of Income Tax. Another judgment has come, Bangalore Club versus Commissioner of Wealth Tax. So in this way, you can go page by page. You can go to page number 2, you can go page by page and go on searching the judgments in the receding order of the time or the date. So in that sense, the search engine is quite powerful, and the repository of NJRS in terms of the number of cases also quite big. For example, now we are presented with this page number 2. Here you find that, okay, this judgment has come 22/7/2020. This is the DIT International Taxation Delhi versus Samsung Heavy Industries. And another judgment here, you can see Ramnath and Company versus the Commissioner of Income Tax. This judgment has come on 5 June 2020. Now, if you want to read this judgment, all you have to do is click here on the name of the judgment. And when you click on the name of the judgment, you are taken to the judgment metadata. Metadata means that some summary aspects of the judgment as to when it was passed, who was the filer of the case, things like that, and which was the court, what was the name of the authority, what was the name of the appellant, respondent, and NJRS gives a document number also. So this judgment is known by this document number, the order date. So some basic data about the case is given here. Some key phrases are also taken from here and given for that particular judgment, so that if it is searched by that key phrase, the judgment will get listed automatically. Now, you can see the comment here. This is a small summary of this particular judgment that has come. Now, in case you want to read, if you want to download this summary, you can press this download button or print it from here. But if you want to take the entire judgment, you go to text. And when you go to text, the judgment loads. And as the judgment loads, you can see that there are 97 pages to this judgment. If you want to download it, the button over here is there to download this judgment. And all you have to do is click the button to download the judgment. As you can see, I'm clicking this button. And as I click the button, I'm presented with a screen where it is asking me whether you want to save this judgment over there. So I can give a name to this judgment. And the date is already visible here as part of the name. It's part of the number of the judgment itself. So you save it here. So like this, you can search for the judgments in NGRS. It's a very useful search, which you can do at any time of your convenience. Now let me take you to some interesting judgments. And of course, you can see the source also, because this judgment has been mentioned by Shri Sanjeev Sharma, who's a IRS officer of 1989 batch. And this article is written in the latest issue of the tax log. You are all having access to tax log now because it is widely shared. In fact, I found that Tax Guru and many other websites are taking articles from tax log and putting it on, you know, on their websites also, sometimes after taking permission of the concerned officer also. So that is giving a wide publicity to these articles that are being published on tax law. So here, NRA Iron and Steel Private Limited case, the Supreme Court judgment is highlighted by Shri Sanjeev Sharma. And this particular judgment is very good because it is a landmark decision. As has been mentioned here, it is passed on 5th of March 2019 in the case of NRA Iron and Steel. Now, what is important about this judgment is that it deals with Section 68, how to make addition under Section 68. And some very important tips are there to be used by our officers who are using these sections to make additions. So if you are invoking Section 68 at any time, this judgment is going to be a very, very useful judgment. So first of all, how this Section 68, what are the preconditions? They are mentioned in the judgment. And what the assessing officer is duty bound to do. Now, in what case the addition would be made. The article also highlights the problems that what we have not been doing. And so we strongly recommend that kindly read this judgment. So in the case of the facts of NRA Iron Steel case are mentioned there, that assessing company had received 17.6 crore rupees capital premium from various companies which were situated in various places. Shares had a face value of 10 rupees and they were subscribed at the rate of 190 rupees per share. Entire share capital, assessee said, has been received through normal banking channels, by account pay, checks, demand drafts, etc. And he also produced the documents like income tax return, acknowledgements, to establish that the identity is there, to establish the identity and the genuineness of the transaction. And he said, okay, my onus is fully discharged. Then what the AO did was that he issued summons to those investor companies, but no one appeared on behalf of any of the investor companies before the AO. Only the submissions were received by post. So the AO summarized the result of his inquiry in the assessment order. AO recorded that inquiries at Mumbai revealed that out of the four companies, two companies were found to be non-existent at that address. About Calcutta companies, response came through post only. Guwahati companies were all non-existent at the given address. So the AO held that none of these investor companies could justify the investment at such a high premium of Rs. 190 per each share, for a face value of Rs. 10 per share. Some of the investor companies are non-existent also. So the AO added back this 17.6 crore rupees to the total income of the SSE on the ground that SSE had failed to discharge the onus by cogent evidence, either of credit worthiness of the investor companies or for the genuineness of the transaction. Now, then what happened was that it went to the CIT appeals. So CIT appeal deleted this addition of the assessing officer on the ground that SSE has filed the confirmations from the companies and he has also filed the income tax returns. He has also filed the acknowledgements with the BAN numbers, copies of the bank accounts, and to show that entire amount had been paid through normal banking channel. And so initial onus, which was there upon SSE, as he has discharged that onus. The tribunal also was very happy with the order of the CIT appeals. And they confirmed the order of the CIT appeals that the SSE had discharged his primary onus to establish the identity and credit worthiness of the investors. So everybody believed till the tribunal that the primary responsibility was definitely with the SSE, but that onus has been discharged by submitting these details and documents. Then the revenue went to the High Court, and the High Court dismissed the appeal filed by the revenue. And it said that no substantial question of law was arising for their consideration in this matter. Now then the matter went to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court considered the issue that in a case involving the credit in the books of accounts by way of share capital, onus is on the SSE that he has to establish by cogent and reliable evidence the identity and the creditworthiness and the genuineness of the transaction. Now, then what happens is that after having stated this initially, the initial onus is on the SSE to establish through cogent evidence. SSE has to establish the three ingredients, as you can see above: the proof of the identity of the creditor, the capacity or the credit worthiness, and the genuineness. These are the three things we all know. We have been discussing all these things. Now, after the SSE discharges the initial burden, then what the AO must do? AO must conduct an inquiry and call for more details before invoking Section 68. As soon as SSE discharges the initial burden, if the AO starts, you know, rejecting it straight away without conducting more inquiry and calling for more details, it may be difficult for the AO. Thereafter, the Supreme Court discussed various case laws like CIT versus Kamdhenu Steel 2012. Delhi High Court held that the assessing officer ought to conduct an independent inquiry to verify the genuineness. So Supreme Court has noted in this case, the assessing officer made an independent inquiry. He also did a survey of the investor companies to verify the credit worthiness and the source of the funds invested and the genuineness. And the field reports revealed that the shareholders were either non-existent or the lacked credit worthiness. There's another case of Delhi High Court CIT versus NR Portfolio. In that also it was held that the credit worthiness or genuineness of a transaction regarding share application money depends on whether two parties are related to or known to each other, or by which mode the parties have approached each other, whether the transaction it has been through written documentation to protect the investment, whether investor was an angel investor, what was the quantum of the money, creditworthiness, object, purpose, etc., etc. Now, Supreme Court observed that a SSE is under legal obligation to prove the receipt of share capital to the satisfaction of the assessing officer. And if he is not able to furnish this, then he will not have a case in favor of him himself. The Honorable Court then observed that authorities below means the CIT appeals and the ITAT and the High Court. They did not even refer to the field inquiries that were made by the assessing officer. The beauty of this case is that the assessing officer's view is standing. The Supreme Court has observed that the entire transaction seems bogus and it lacks credibility. It cannot be believed. Just because assessee filed all the primary evidence, it cannot be said that onus of the assessee has been discharged completely. So by stating this, Supreme Court has raised the bar of the onus. It has raised the burden upon the assessee to establish by cogent and reliable evidence. So this raising the bar has happened in this case. There was no material on record, even remotely, given by the assessee to suggest that the share application was received from any independent legal entity. The survey was done and survey revealed that some of the companies were non-existent and they had no office at that address. Now, the inquiries also revealed that investor companies had filed returns which were having negligible taxable income, which can show that the investors did not have the financial capacity also to invest the funds, ranging between 90 lakh to 95 lakh. When somebody is going into huge losses, how can they have so much of cash flow? There was no explanation whatsoever which was offered as to why the investor companies had applied for shares of the assessing company at such a high premium. The company is going into a loss. So the source of funds could not be established. Mere mention of income tax file number or something like that, PAN number, whatever, it is not sufficient to discharge the onus. Just because it has gone through the banking channel doesn't mean that the onus has been discharged. So, after having gone through this judgment, it's a very useful judgment. All of the assessing officers must go through this judgment. And some suggestions have been made by Mr. Sanjeev Sharma, Principal CIT. Some very useful suggestions have been given here that you must take care of these things if you want to make additions. Good addition under Section 68. So the assessee will not be able to escape with just giving some preliminary documents. So these are some of the questions that Mr. Sharma has given a questionnaire here. That questionnaire can be used by anyone, by the officers. Some in-detail inquiry can be done on the basis of this questionnaire. So in case this questionnaire is utilized, that will lead to a detailed inquiry and a good addition in case the assessee is not able to satisfy these inquiries. So when the word satisfaction of the assessing officer is mentioned, it relates to an inquiry which is being made by the assessing officer. So that is how I wanted to bring to your notice this particular judgment, which I thought was a really good judgment. In this tax log article, I also want to point out to you a little more of one more article, okay, which is on the revisionary powers under Section 263 of the Income Tax Act. Now, this article is also another wonderful article written by IRS officers Nidhi Srivastav and Mr. Satpal Gulati of 92 and 93 batch respectively. And they have brought out very beautifully how 263 matters can be made successful. So very strong recommendation to you all, to kindly go through this particular article also. Now, having gone through that, let us go into some of the summary of some of the judgments that have been passed recently by the Supreme Court. Now, there is one called Shilpa Chaudhary versus the CIT. Now, here, in this case, what had happened was that the warrant of authorization was issued under Section 132(1) in the case of the K group, who are the primary persons against whom the warrant of authorization was issued. Now, once the warrant of authorization was issued, search and seizure operation was carried out at the petitioner, at the petitioner's premise. Petitioner is Shilpa Chaudhary. Now, in the warrant of authorization, Shilpa Chaudhary's address was also mentioned, and they therefore they made a search operation there also. The panchanama was prepared under that warrant of authorization, which was issued against the primary person, who is not Shilpa Chaudhary. And then some inventory of six items was made, including a bank locker that was also found at the petitioner's premises. Now, once this bank locker was found, the statement of V. Chaudhary and Shilpa Chaudhary was recorded, and they were asked about this locker key. Now, they could not give a proper explanation of this locker key. So that what the department did was it issued the warrant of authorization against both of these persons, V. Chaudhary and S. Chaudhary, Shilpa Chaudhary, so that the bank locker could be searched, because the bank locker was belonging to V. Chaudhary and Shilpa Chaudhary and not to the K group. So a separate search warrant was issued. A warrant of authorization was issued against these two persons, and seizure of the jewelry was made. Now, thereafter, with the help of this new warrant of authorization, the search was resumed at the petitioner premises, and a final panchanama was now drawn, and the petitioner's statement was also recorded. That means Shilpa Chaudhary's statement was recorded. Then a notice for assessment proceeding was issued to the petitioner, and the other petitioner's wife was similarly also aggrieved with the warrant of authorization. They made writ petitions in the Supreme Court, and on writ petition it was contended that a search and seizure action was entirely arbitrary and malafide, and that the search carried out under warrant of authorization was beyond the scope of the statute, and therefore this warrant was illegal. Now, the Supreme Court holds in this case a recently passed judgment, I think just at the end of the last year, 2020. The Supreme Court holds that the initial search proceedings in the residential premises of the petitioner were conducted in relation to 132(1) proceeding in respect of some other persons, primary persons, so to say. But when the locker key was recovered in that search, the locker key belonging to VC and Shilpa Chaudhary. And these two petitioners were questioned about the locker key. They were not able to give satisfactory answers. And then, therefore, a fresh warrant of authorization was issued against them. And from this point, therefore, there were two separate proceedings. One was against the K group and the other was against these petitioners. Because the proceeding against these petitioners were in respect of the independent warrant of authorization, a separate warrant of authorization. So the petitioners failed to provide acceptable explanation in respect of the valuables which were kept in that locker, and since a new and separate proceeding was there, it was not a consequential warrant of the earlier proceeding, it was a separate search proceeding. So any business connection link and any association between the petitioners and the primary search party was therefore not required. If this new warrant of authorization had not been issued, then this case would have fallen flat. But owing to the wonderful work done by our officers, this wonderful judgment, Supreme Court, has come in favor of the department. Now there is another judgment called National Cooperative Development Corporation versus CIT, Delhi Supreme Court 2020. The question that arises here in this case is that whether component of the interest income which is earned on the funds received under Section 13(1) of the NCDC Act, because National Cooperative Development Corporation is set up under the NCDC Act, National Cooperative Development Act. So under that act, there is a section, and under that section, they get the funds or the grants. And in turn, they disburse these grants by way of grants to national and state level cooperative societies. So this is the primary level body or the apex level body of the cooperative societies. So the question that was arising here in this case was that whether the component of the interest income which is earned by NCDC on the grants which are given was eligible for deduction for determining the taxable income of NCDC. In this case, the SSE was established in 62. SSE is an intermediary, only pass-through entity. Money comes to the SSE passes on that money. Grant comes to them, they pass on the grant to the other cooperative societies, the state level cooperative societies or the national level cooperative societies. So SSE is an intermediary. It is a separate juridical entity which has been created by an act. Its taxation status was, insofar as funds were received from the central government, these were treated as capital receipts. And hence, they were not chargeable to tax. So NCDC was not paying any tax on the funds which were being received as grants from the government, because those grants were treated as capital receipts. Now, with respect to the interest component that was earned, that was treated as taxable income. And it was logically taxed as business income. So the assessing officer was of the opinion that the non-refundable grants were in the nature of capital expenditure and not a revenue expenditure. And it thus disallowed the same as a deduction. So the AO disallowed the grants which were given by NCDC to the other state level cooperative societies and disallowed it, saying that they were capital expenditures, because what the money, when it was coming in, it was capital income for them. So the AO noted that no deduction has sought for has been claimed in the previous years also by this SSE. So he's following a previous practice also. Of course, subsequently the stand of the SSC Corporation, as the SSC was that the same was a mistake. SSC said that I have not claimed earlier, but it was a mistake. I should have claimed it as a revenue expenditure, and I will not be bound by. I could not be bound by what I have claimed in the earlier years. Now, the AO did not agree with the SSC. Then matter went to the CIT appeals. After the disallowance was made, the CIT appeal opined that the grant which was made by the SSC, undisputedly it fell within its authorized activities. There is no doubt about it. SSC was doing authorized activity, and that activity was interlinked and interconnected with its main business of advancing loans on interest to state governments and cooperative societies. So these grants were intended to be utilized for various projects which were admittedly of capital nature, and it resulted in acquisition of capital assets also, but not by the SSC. Not they were those capital assets were not the capital assets of the SSC. Thus, the CIT appeals reached a conclusion that in terms of Section 37, any expenditure laid out or expenditure wholly and exclusively for the purpose of the business was allowable as a deduction. So CIT appeals found that the AO's approach was fallacious, and therefore it disagreed with the AO. Thereafter, the matter went to the ITAT, and the ITAT accepted the AO's view and did not agree with the approach of the CIT appeal. So the ITAT rejected the CIT appeals view and agreed with AO's view, and it set aside the order of the CIT appeals, and it held that the grants or the additional grants and other sums which were received by the SSC from the central government, they went into a single fund and they were not treated as its income, and thus the disbursement which was made from the same could not be treated as revenue expenditure. So the disbursement of the monies to the state governments and cooperative societies were held to be purely and simple application of the fund that was received under Section 13(2) of the NCDC Act, and it could not be an expenditure in the nature of the revenue. The High Court had the opinion there that since the business of the SSC was to receive funds and to then advance them as loans, the interest income which was earned, which was so applied, could also fall under the head D of Section 14 of Chapter 4 of the IT Act, under the head profits and gains of business or profession, which were therefore a part of the normal business activity of the SSC. So it was held by the High Court that monies which were advanced from the fund could not be distinctly identified as forming part of the interest income. So the other aspect the High Court opined on was that in order to claim deduction as a revenue expenditure, the SSC had to first establish that it incurred an expenditure. The advancement of loans to state governments could not be claimed as expenditure, as the same did not leave the hands of the SSC irretrievably. But then the matter came to the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Court has held that disbursement of the grant, which was a non-refundable grant, it was an integral part of the business of the SSC, as contemplated under Section 13(1) of the NCDC Act, whatever business was contemplated, and thus the money is being spent for purpose of the business. The purpose was direct mainly because the grants benefit a third party. It would not render the disbursement as applicable application of income and not expenditure. Rather, it will be an expenditure. Logical conclusion is that every application of income towards business objective of SSC was business expenditure and nothing else. So the business of the SSC was to provide loans or grants for the object for which it has been set up. Thus, the amount which is agreed to be given should be given as a loan or grant or both. It was entirely at the discretion of the SSE whether he wants to give a loan or the grant. No grantee could decide whether he had a superior title to the funds or he had to return back the funds or not. The decision was of the NCDC. Therefore, this is not a case of diversion of income by overriding title. It is going through the SSE's business itself. So therefore, whatever expenditure has been made, whatever grants have been given, they are allowable expenditure. Now let's come to another judgment, ACIT versus Marico Industries, which is selling probably parachute oil. It is on section 148. Now, whether the assessment could be reopened, the question is whether the assessment could be reopened where the AO had not rejected the explanation offered by the SSE in the assessment order. So what the AO did in this case was that he made certain queries during the assessment proceedings from the SSE, and SSE responded to those queries. Now after assessing officer, he took into consideration those responses and then he passed the order, assessment order. Thereafter, after passing the order, he issued notice under section 148. And he sought to reopen the matter. So in this case, while accepting the challenge to the issuance of the notice, the High Court observed that the reasons in support of the notice was the very issue in respect of which the AO had raised the query. Whatever reasons the AO gave to reopen the case, they were the same reasons with respect to which he had raised queries during the assessment proceedings. And SSE had all responded to them also. But the AO did not reject the explanation of the SSE in the assessment order, though he had raised the query. So since the AO did not reject the explanation of the assessment order, explanation of the SSE in the assessment order, that meant that AO had accepted the view of the SSE. Thus, it was taking a view, forming an opinion. Therefore, in such circumstances, the reasons in support of the notice, they were just a mere change of opinion. When SSE has replied to the queries, assessing officer has taken them into consideration, but he has not rejected them. That means he had a certain opinion, he had formed an opinion on that reply, but he did not reject it. And later on, he seems to arrive at a different opinion. And therefore, this was the case of a change of opinion on part of the assessing officer, and therefore, assessing officer did not have the jurisdiction to issue 148, because on mere change of opinion, assessing officer cannot issue 148. Accordingly, this 148 was quashed and set aside. Now, let's come to another judgment. It's called Pilcom versus CID, the Supreme Court judgment 2020. The question that is asked here in this case is whether the tax was required to be deducted at source on payments made to non-resident sports association in India. Payments are being made in India to sports associations who are non-resident, and these payments are made on account of guarantee money which was paid through the bank accounts at London or at different places. SSC was in this case a committee which was formed by the cricket control board of three countries, Pakistan, India and Sri Lanka. And this committee was formed for purpose of conducting the World Cup cricket tournament for the year 1996, because the World Cup was being held in these three countries. Now this particular company, this particular committee opened two bank accounts also in London, which they were jointly operating through representatives of Indian and the Pakistan cricket boards. Now, in these bank accounts, the receipt from the sponsorship, TV rights, etc. were deposited, and from these bank accounts, the expenses were also met. Whatever was the surplus amount remaining in the bank accounts after making the expenditures, it was decided that it will be divided equally between the cricket boards of Pakistan and India after paying a lump sum amount to Sri Lankan board as per their mutual agreement. Now, for the purpose of hosting the World Cup matches, the BCCI appointed its own committee for discharge of its responsibility and functions. The committee was to be known as INDICOM. So the committee convener secretary of the INDICOM was functioning from Calcutta. Necessary bank accounts were opened in Calcutta by INDICOM, and all the amounts which were received were transferred into this bank account. Now, when the inquiry was held, it came to the knowledge of ITO TDS that Pilcom had made payments to ICC as well as to the cricket board associations of the different other member countries from the two London bank accounts. So ITO issued a notice to the office of Pilcom to show cause why action under 201/194E should not be taken, why they have not deducted tax at source. And then it was also stated that the books of accounts of Pilcom was not being completed by its Pakistani treasurer. The said books could not be produced before the ITO. ITO did not agree with the contentions of Pilcom. He referred the provisions of section 115 BBA, and he held that taxes should have been deducted at source from the payments made by Pilcom in accordance with the 194E provisions. Finally, the ITO passed an order under 201/194E and held that Pilcom was liable to pay interest also on the said amounts from the date on which the tax was deductible up to the date of actual payment. SSC went into appeal and CIT appeal disposed of the appeal. The ITAT set aside the order passed by the CIT appeals and restored the matter back to the file of the CIT appeal. Again, the CIT appeal finally passed its appellate order, which was challenged before ITAT again. The tribunal now held that only that proportion of the total receipt made by each such country from Pilcom, which bears the same ratio as the number of the matches played, to the total number of matches played by each such country in the tournament, should be considered to be income arising or accruing to the cricket association of that particular country. Thus, tribunal has opined that Pilcom should have deducted tax at source in respect of this portion of the amount. And therefore, order under section 201 was said to be valid in respect of payment to each such country in the above calculated manner. Then matter went to High Court. High Court held that once the payment was made and received by way of participation in any matches played in India, the said India by the resident SSC had to meet deduction of tax under section 115 BBA. Similarly, if any amount including the guaranteed amount was paid to any non-resident sports association in relation to any match which was played in India, the said income had to be subjected to deduction at source. So SSC was agreed with that judgment of the High Court, and SSC comes to the Supreme Court. Now, what does the Supreme Court say? The Supreme Court holds that the payments which are described as guarantee money, they were connected with the event, the cricket event, where cricket teams were scheduled to play, and they participated in the events also. So the source of income was in the playing of matches. Now, 115BB(a)(1)(b) mandates that its mandate was also clear in that if the total income of a non-resident sports association included the amount which is guaranteed to be paid or payable to it in relation to any game or sports, then the amount of income tax which is calculated shall become payable. On such premise, it must be held that the payments which is made to the non-resident sports association in the present case represented their income which accrued or arose or was deemed to have accrued or arisen in India. Consequently, the assessee was liable to deduct tax. So this is a very good clarificatory judgment. I want to bring you to Yum Restaurants judgment. Yum Restaurants Marketing Private Limited versus Commissioner of Income Tax Delhi. And in this, the question was that whether the SSE would be qualifying as a mutual concern. So the question of mutuality was discussed in this particular judgment. Now, the facts of this case were like this, that SSE was a company, Yum Restaurants Marketing Private Limited. It was incorporated by the parent company, which was also called Yum something, Yum RIPL. Now, why RIPL, Yum RIPL incorporated Yum RMPL? And this Yum RMPL was a subsidiary and a fully owned subsidiary of YRIPL. And now this YRIPL, it obtained the approval from the Secretariat for the Industrial Assistance to economize the cost of the advertising and promotion of the franchises as per their needs. The approval was granted to it, subject to certain conditions as regards the functioning of the SSE, whereby it was obligated that it was made necessary that it will operate on a non-profit basis on the principle of mutuality. It was supposed to go by the principles of mutuality on a non-profit basis. Now, after this approval, the SSE entered into a three-party agreement. It's called a tripartite agreement with the parent company YRIPL and its other franchises also, by which the SSE received fixed contribution of 5% of gross sales for proper conduct of the advertising, marketing and promotional activities for the mutual benefit of the parent company and the franchises. Now the SSE filed the return stating that income is nil, that I am having a mutuality character, but it was not accepted by the AO. AO observed that as per SIA or the agreement, the SSE company along with their franchises were supposed to contribute a fixed percentage of their revenue to this company, SSE company via MPL. However, the tripartite operating agreement, the SSE company had its sole absolute discretion to pay to YRMPL any amount as it may deem appropriate. So by doing this tripartite agreement, some clauses which were made compulsory by SIA were not followed, and therefore the change was made here that instead of a fixed percentage, the power came to the YRIPL to give whatever money they wanted to give to YRMPL. And YRIPL will have no obligation to pay any such amounts if it chooses not to do so. Now, this clearly showed that YRIPL was under no legal obligation to pay any amount of contribution as per its own version which was reflected in the tripartite agreement that it made. So, assessing officer levied the liability upon the assessee company, and CIT appeals also upheld it on the ground that there was a taint of commerciality in the activities and not the element of mutuality. The liability was further confirmed by the tribunal, wherein the essential ingredients of the doctrine of mutuality were found to be missing by the tribunal also. A consistent line of opinion recorded by all the aforementioned below forums was further approved by High Court also. So all the parties have been stating the same thing, right from the below level to the highest level. The High Court also observed that in the present case, the authorities below had returned a finding of the fact that the contributors such as Pepsi Food did not benefit from the APM activities. Moreover, the principle of mutuality was applicable to those entities whose activities are not tinged with commercial purpose. Now, in the instant case, what is happening is that the parent company, which had contributed to the brand fund, was under the agreement under no obligation to contribute there. The contributions of IRIPL were at its own discretion. Thus, looking at the facts obtaining in the present case, it was quite clear that principle of mutuality would not be applicable to the instant case. Hence, the assessee filed the appeal before the Supreme Court. Now, what the Supreme Court says? The Supreme Court says that no person ought to contribute to the common fund without having the entitlement to participate as a beneficiary in the surplus thereof. This, they are trying to explain mutuality principle. That a person who can participate in that surplus, he should only be the contributor. And conversely, no person ought to participate as a beneficiary without first having been a contributor. So if you don't contribute, you don't become a beneficiary. That's the basic principle of mutuality. Common identity as it occurred in the present context signified that the class of members should stay intact as the transaction progresses from the stage of contributions to that of the item surplus. In this case, identity was clear common of the persons who are involved and was going to be fixed. The moment such a transaction opens itself to non-members, either in the contribution or the surplus, the uniformity of the identity gets impaired. So, in the mutuality, there has to be a uniformity of identity, which will get impaired if you open it for non-members, and the transaction assumes the taint of the commercial transaction there. Now, in this case, Pepsi Food was a contributor to the common pool of the funds. However, it did not participate in the surplus as a beneficiary of the funds which were accumulating. Notably, Pepsi Foods was not a franchisee and thus it could not participate in the surplus at all. Secondly, Pepsi did not enjoy any right of participation in the surplus or any right to receive back the surplus, which are mandatory ingredients to sustain the principle of mutuality. So, right to receive back the surplus and right of participation in the surplus, these are important ingredients. The assessee was realizing money both from the members as well as from the non-members in the course of the same activity carried on by it. Thus, such operations were antithetical to mutuality. They did not support the principle of mutuality. Therefore, the three-pronged test has been given there of mutuality that gets severed. So once it is conclusively determined that the assessing company had not operated as mutual concern, which it was supposed to do actually, but it did not do it because of the tripartite agreement, so there will be no question of extending exemption from tax liability, and therefore they will have to pay the tax. So even Supreme Court has agreed here finally. Now let's go to another judgment called Basir Ahmed Sisodia versus ITO Supreme Court 2020. The question that was supposed to be answered here whether the addition which was made under section 68 in respect of purchases made from unregistered dealers could be maintained, wherein penalty proceedings the department had accepted the explanation of the SSE regarding the concerned unregistered dealers. So the facts are like this, that SSE was given a notice, 143-2 notice for assessment year 98-99, and then an assessment order was passed. Now, in the assessment order, you observed that the credits of 2,26,000 rupees was shown in name of 15 persons. But this was unexplained under section 68, and he added this amount, therefore, in the declared income of the SSE. Now, it went to the CIT appeal. The CIT appeal partly allowed the appeal of the SSE, but it upheld the assessment order with respect to trading account and the credits. Then the matter went to the ITAT. ITAT also partly allowed the appeal. However, the order relating to the addition under consideration regarding the credits of 2,26,000, this one came to be upheld. So the SSE filed before the High Court. The main argument of the SSE was that once the books of accounts were rejected and an assessment order was passed, the same books of accounts could not be relied upon by the assessing officer to impose consequent additions. Now, the High Court dismissed the appeal as being devoid of merits. The High Court opined that the amount which was shown as credit was nothing but bogus entry, and it was justly added to the income of the appellant. So basically, assessing officer is winning up to the High Court level here. Hence, the SSE filed appeal before the Supreme Court. Now, in the Supreme Court, the revenue contended that the officer gave several opportunities to the SSE to prove the authenticity of the entries in question, that those 15 entries of 2,26,000. Now, it also said that the summon notices were issued to the named 15 creditors, but no evidence or no explanation came. However, what happened was that when the order under section 271C for same assessment year was passed, in that order the CIT appeals rendered a finding that SSE had not made any concealment of income regarding this 2,26,000 rupees or furnished any inaccurate particulars. So CIT appeal gave relief to the SSE, saying that there was no concealment of income, there was no furnishing of the inaccurate particulars. Now, it is very interesting here that High Court has already ruled in favor of the department. Now, the CIT appeal is rendering a finding on the penalty issue, that there is no penalty leviable here because there is no concealment, nor there is any inaccurate particulars being furnished. Now, in respect of the addition of rupees 2,26,000, it was held that without the purchase of marbles, there could not have been a sale. You know, when there is a sale, there must be some purchase also, and disclosure in the closing stock also, trading stock also. And therefore, it suggested that the SSE must have purchased marble slabs from unregistered dealers. Thus, there was no justification. So the CIT appeals is saying all these things. And the CIT appeal said that there was no justification not to accept the purchases made from the unregistered dealers. Now, consequent to that order which was passed by the CIT appeals, the department had refunded the penalty amount to the SSE. Now this means the department had allowed the said order to become final, because department refunded the amount to the parent, to the SSE, and did not go in appeal on this. So the Supreme Court holds in this case that reverting to the finding and conclusion which were recorded by the assessing by the officer and by the appellate authority as well as the High Court, it must follow that SSE, despite being given sufficient opportunity, he failed to prove the correctness and genuineness of his claim in respect of the purchases of marbles from unregistered dealers. Now, no doubt about this, the SSE was not able to prove the purchase of the marbles. But, however, what happened was that in the penalty proceeding, SSE offered the explanation and caused to produce some affidavits. And he caused to record some statements of the concerned unregistered dealers also, and he established their credentials also. That he did that during the penalty proceedings. So the appellate authority had accepted the explanation which was offered by the appellant SSE. So in this situation, the appellate authority had not only accepted the explanation, he had also recorded a clear finding of fact that there was no concealment of the income nor any furnishing of any inaccurate particulars for assessment year 1998-99. So now, that being the indisputable position, it must follow that addition was justified. So all the authorities up to High Court, the department was winning, and here the Supreme Court has overturned it and deleted the addition, set aside the addition that was made. So that's how, that is why this particular judgment becomes very interesting, because it's a very peculiar judgment. SSE is not able to prove before the High Court, before the assessing officer, and that fact was accepted. But in the penalty proceeding, CIT appeals gave a judgment in favor of the SSE, saying there is no penalty proceedings required, and no penalty requires to be imposed, and the penalty amount should be refunded. Department refunded the penalty amount. So if the department has refunded the penalty amount, it has a bad reflection upon the main assessment order, and the addition also goes. Now we come to another judgment called the NDTV versus DCIT. This is also a Supreme Court judgment, 2020. Section 148, once again, as always, and on, I think in the finance bill, the time of reopening has been reduced. So Section 148 is becoming more and more difficult to use, and therefore whatever the department needs to do, it should do in the assessment, main assessment proceedings, and should not resort to 148 unless there is a very strong case on 148. So Section 148, whether the assessment could be reopened on the basis of material disclosed in the assessment proceeding for subsequent years. The facts of this case were that SSE, which is NDTV, it had submitted return for AY 2008-09 and declared a loss. Part of the assessment order had related to issue of step-up coupon bonds amounting to $100 million. Now these coupon bonds were issued in July 2007 through the Bank of New York for a period of 5 years. These bonds were to be redeemed at a premium of 7.5% after 5 years. However, these bonds were redeemed in advance at a discounted price of 74.2 million in November 2009. Now, AO held that NNPLC had virtually no financial worth. It had no business of the name, and therefore it could not be believed that it could have issued convertible bonds of US 100 million. So AO doubted that there was a genuine case where SSE was a loss-making company, and how could it issue a 100 million bonds? unless the repayment of those repayment along with the interest was secured. So AO did not, however, doubt the validity of the transaction, but he imposed a guarantee fee rate of 4.68% by treating it as a business transaction, and he added rupees 18.72 crores to the income of the assessor. Thereafter, revenue sent a notice to the assessee wherein it was stated that the authority had reason to believe that net income chargeable to tax for assessment year 2008-9 had escaped assessment within the meaning of section 148. Now, interesting thing is that here assessee had filed a return for loss for 8-9. Now, so the revenue sent a 148 notice to the SSE. The main reason which was given was that in the following assessment year, AO had proposed a substantial addition of 642 crores to the account of the SSE on account of monies raised by the SSE through its subsidiaries. One of the subsidiary was NMPLC. The SSE filed a reply to the notice and the reasons which were given and claimed that there had been no failure on the part of the SSE to disclose all material facts fully and truly. The objections were rejected. Aggrieved, the SSE filed a writ petition in the High Court challenging the notice. The writ petition was dismissed. Against this, the SSE had filed the present appeal in the Supreme Court. So the case of the SSE was the transaction of step-up coupon bond was scrutinized in great detail by the AO before he passed the order of assessment. Therefore, according to the SSE, there was no fresh material before the AO to have reason to believe that the undisclosed income of the SSE had escaped assessment. Revenue submitted had since the revenue discovered fresh tangible material subsequent to the assessment order. In a subsequent year, SSE has discovered new material. Assessing officer has discovered new tangible material, fresh material. It cannot be said that the AO did not have reason to believe that income had escaped assessment. Now, Supreme Court holds here that subsequent facts which came to the knowledge of AO can be taken into account to decide whether the assessment proceeding should be reopened or not. So, therefore, information which came to the notice of the AO during the proceedings for subsequent years could form tangible material to invoke 147. Therefore, the material that was disclosed in assessment proceeding for subsequent years was sufficient to form the view that the case has to be reopened. Therefore, the reasons to believe were there. Thereafter, the next question here was that whether the assessment could be reopened where there was no failure on part of the assessee to disclose the facts. Now, the assessee says that I have disclosed all the facts truly and fully. Why you are reopening my case? You have already examined my case in the earlier year also. You have examined the step-up coupon bonds in the earlier year also. Why you are reopening my case? I have disclosed everything fully and truly. I have not concealed anything. So the assessee submitted a return for assessment year 2008-9. Again, the same facts were there. So Supreme Court has given a judgment in favor of the department here that can reopen the case. And it has held that no doubt, SSE had disclosed all the material facts before the AO and it was not required to give any further assistance to the AO by disclosure of other facts. But AO did not doubt the transaction or the genuineness on the basis of those facts. So we are not leading to any conclusion that SSE did not disclose fully and truly. We are only leading to the conclusion that income has escaped a suspect. Now, whether there was another question here that whether the second proviso to section 47 could be applied and limitation of 16 years could be applied, where there was nothing in the reasons to indicate that revenue was intending to apply the extended period of 16 years. So the facts are again the same. It was held by the Supreme Court that the fact was that the notice, in the notice there was no mention of any foreign entity at all. There was only mention of the section 148. There was nothing in the reasons to indicate the revenue was intending to apply the period of 16 years here. If the revenue was to rely upon the second proviso and wanted to apply the limitation of 16 years, would apply. I think this ought to be 6 years. Then in the notice, or at least in the reasons in support of the notice, the SSE should have been put to notice that the revenue relied upon the second proviso. It was necessary to tell the SSE that we will use the second proviso before in this case. So therefore, the notice which was issued to the SSE and supported the reasons did not invoke the provisions of the second proviso. And therefore, at this stage, the revenue could not be permitted to take benefit of the second proviso. So here it is to this extent that all the earlier years could not be reopened, because in the notice we did not mention that we are using second proviso. And a small mistake has led to a loss of revenue therefore. So the Supreme Court allowed the appeal by holding that the notice which was issued to the SSE, it showed the sufficient reason to believe to reopen the assessment, but since the revenue had failed to show the non-disclosure of the facts, the notice having been issued after a period of 4 years was required to be quashed in that sense of the matter. So a small mistake led to a big error here. Now, Rajasthan State Electricity Board versus the Deputy Commissioner of Income Tax. This is a 143(1)(a) matter. The question that has arisen is that whether the SSE can be levied additional tax under Section 143(1)(a) on the ground that SSE had claimed 100% depreciation instead of 75% depreciation, where the claim was not made by the SSE with the intention of any tax evasion. The question arises here. SSE says that I am a government company. I filed my return for assessment year 91-92 showing loss. There was a bona fide mistake and I claimed 100% depreciation on written down value instead of 75% depreciation, because I did not know that the act had been amended to reduce 100% to 75%. However, the unamended section 32(2), the SSE was entitled to claim 100% depreciation, that is before amendment, but after the amendment, he could get only 75%. So when the SSE filed a return, he should have actually claimed 75%, but he claimed 100%. An intimation was issued by the AO disallowing the 25% of depreciation, restricting the depreciation to 75%. And additional tax was demanded. The SSE filed an application under Section 154 that the demand should be rectified. SSE also filed a petition under Section 264. That this additional demand should not be there, additional tax demand. Now, 154 was also dismissed, 264 was also dismissed by the CIT. Then, again, the 264 order, the SSE filed the petition before High Court. A single judge of the High Court caused the levy of additional tax. Thereafter, revenue filed special appeal allowed by this High Court. Filed a special appeal in the Supreme Court. now, which was allowed by the High Court, upholding the demand of additional tax. Now, so High Court upheld what the AO has said. The SSE was aggrieved and it moved Supreme Court. Now, Supreme Court says that depreciation was claimed by SSE in the return due to bona fide mistake. By the Taxation Amendment Act 91, depreciation was restricted to 75%, but due to oversight, it was missed by the SSE while filing return. But the CIT, by deciding the revision petition, had also not made any observation to the effect that 100% depreciation claim by the SSE was with the intention to evade payment of tax. So there was no allegation against the SSE that there was an intention to evade the payment of tax. In the present case, not even a whisper was made that claim of 100% of depreciation was with the intention to evade the tax. And therefore, the Supreme Court has held that mechanical application of Section 143(1)(a) in the facts of the present case was not called for and should not have been done. Of course, if a conclusion was drawn that there was an intention to evade the tax, then that could have been done. So the Supreme Court has allowed this appeal. Next, we go to another important judgment, Super Malls Private Limited versus PCIT 2020 Supreme Court. And in this, Section 153C is being discussed. In this case, the question that is arisen to decide is whether there was a sufficient compliance of Section 153C in the facts where the satisfaction note written by the AO clearly stated that the document so seized belonged to the SSE and not to the searched person. The facts are that search and seizure was carried out at the residential business premise of Sri Tejwan Singh and Sri Ved Prakash Bharti group of companies. And a survey was also carried out at the business premise of the SSE company, that is Super Malls Private Limited. Now, during the search at the residence of Ved Prakash Bharti, who is a director in Super Malls, a pen drive was found and it was seized. Now, some documents were seized after taking the printout from the above said pen drive. Now, these documents contained the details of the cash receipts because this pen drive was found from the car of Sri Ved Prakash Bharti. And in that, the details were found of the cash receipts on sale of some shops or offices at Besar Super Mall in Karnal. And as a consequence of the search, a notice was issued 153C. EO filed, the SSE filed return for 2008-9. Assessment for 2008-9 was finalized by the EO and additions were made. The assessment order was a subject matter appeal before CIT appeal. The assessment order was challenged mainly on the ground that the satisfaction note, which was recorded under Section 153C in respect of the SSE, which is a third party, was invalid. The CIT appeals had dismissed the SSE's appeal. However, the ITAT allowed the appeal referred by SSE and held that the satisfaction note was invalid in respect to the third party, was invalid. The High Court allowed the appeal preferred by the revenue and it held that there was a compliance of Section 153C. Therefore, the High Court set aside the learned ITAT's decision with respect to the satisfaction note recorded by the AO under Section 153C. So they came to the Supreme Court. SSE said that there was no satisfaction note by the AO of the search party. The satisfaction vote should be given by you of the search party. There was a non-compliance of the provisions of section 153C, which says that you of the search party has to submit a satisfaction note for 153C proceedings. They also quoted a circular issued by CBDT, and therefore ITAT rightly set aside the assessment order. Revenue has opposed that, and they had vehemently submitted that in the facts and circumstances of the case, the High Court had rightly observed that there was sufficient compliance. Now, in this case, what had happened was that EO was satisfied that documents which were seized from the residence of the search person belonged to the SSE. Who is the other person? The satisfaction note by the AO clearly stated that the documents so seized belonged to the other person, and the SSE, who is the SSE and not the search person. Thus, the High Court was justified in observing that the requirement of section 153C was fulfilled. On facts, thus, the Supreme Court was in complete agreement with the view taken by the High Court. In this case, the interesting thing, which is not, I think, which is left out to be mentioned here, is that it was the same officer who was the in the search party and who assessed the case later on. Since the officer who assessed the case was the same person, the same individual, who was the also the EO of the search party. Therefore, this has been allowed by the Supreme Court. Otherwise, the rule is that the EO of the search party has to indicate that, okay, this belongs to any other person. And then only 153C can be initiated. Now, we move on to CIT Udaipur versus Chetak Enterprises, Supreme Court 2020. If deduction under 80IA can be denied carrying to the SSE who is carrying on infrastructure facility on ground of conversion of partnership form into private limited company. In this case, what happened was that SSE was converted from partnership form to the private limited company. A registered form was converted to company before the commencement of the relevant assessment year. Now, under 80IA, benefit is available to companies, but the EO did not think that way. The EO had declined the claim of the SSE, but his decision was reversed by CIT appeals. The ITAT confirmed the decision of the FAA. Following its decision in the case of the SSE company for the assessment year 2001-2. So the High Court, while upholding the view taken by the FAA and the ITAT, dismissed the appeal. The High Court observed that so far as the facts were concerned, it was not in dispute that the work of construction was completed on 27-3-2000. Road construction was completed on and with effect from 28-3-2000. And thereafter, the partnership form was converted into a company by being registered under Part 9 of the Companies Act and became a private limited company. Thus, right from commencement of the relevant financial year, it was a company and was undertaking the specified business. When right from the day one, while replying to the notice inviting tenders itself, was made clear by the firm that the firm will be converting into a limited company. When firm was inviting tender, it had made clear it will be converted into a limited company. And chief engineer was requested to allow the change in the constitution also. And accordingly, change of the name was carried out after converting the firm into the company. In such a case, it cannot be said that it was a firm. Therefore, it could be denied 81A benefit. So, Supreme Court has allowed 81A benefit in this case. Now, another interesting judgment, Maruti versus CIT Delhi, 2020 Supreme Court. The question that is to be answered here is whether reduction could be allowed in respect of mod VAT credit of excise duty that remained unutilized at the end of the relevant accounting year. Now, the facts are like this, that assessing company is manufacturing and selling cars, and is trading in spares and components of vehicles also. So, Assessi being Maruti company was taking benefit of mod VAT credit on the raw material and inputs which were used in the manufacturing. At the end of the assessment year 1999-2000, there was a certain amount which was left unutilized as mod VAT credit, unutilized. In the return, it was claimed that the assessee was eligible for deduction under Section 1, under Section 43B, as an allowable deduction. Now, there is this, in respect of this mod VAT credit, which was lying unutilized also, this claim of 43B was made. Similarly, the assessee claimed deduction under Section 43B of an amount of, in respect of sales tax recoverable account from that account also. EO disallowed the claim. CIT appeals sustained the disallowance of the both the items, but the IDAT took the view that advance payment of excise duty, which represented the unutilized mod VAT credit without incurring the liability, was not an allowable deduction, but it allowed the other deduction. The High Court also was in favor of the revenue. Assessee came to the Supreme Court. Assessee said that the amount which is paid by way of excise duty to the suppliers of raw material and imports was accepted as excise duty under the provisions of Central Excise Act and rules. Consequently, when the payment was made by Assessee to its suppliers, they should be treated as payments of excise duty, and therefore they straight away qualified for reduction under Section 43B. Irrespective of whether when the mod VAT credit arising from such payments was utilized to make payment of excise duty on the products manufactured by the assessor. He says that I am paying my excise duty, so you give me the benefit. The assessee also submitted that the question was squarely covered by 43B first proviso. The revenue, however, submitted that deduction under Section 43B was allowable only when the amount of tax cess were due and payable, and assessee actually pays them. But in the present case, the excise duty became due and payable only when the assessee removed the finished product from the factory gate at the point in time when the assessee made payment to the suppliers. The excise duty was not due to be paid by him because goods had not left the premises, and so excise duty was not due and payable at that point of time. So, answering the submission of the SSC based on the proviso of Section 43B, they submitted that the liability to pay excise duty of the SSC was incurred only on the removal of the finished goods, and that happened in the subsequent year. And therefore, on the end of the year, end of the financial year, the SSC was not able to pay the excise duty, and therefore the proviso would also not come to the aid of the SS. So it was held that the deduction under Section 43B was allowable only when sum was actually paid. Now, in this present case, the excise duty levyable on SSC on manufacture of vehicles was already adjusted in the concerned assessment year from the credit of the excise duty under the mod VAT scheme. The unutilized credit, which is not so far adjusted in the mod VAT scheme, cannot be treated as sum which is actually paid by SSC. Because whatever is adjusted can be treated, but whatever is not adjusted, it is unutilized, cannot be treated as paid. So the SSC, when he paid the cost of the raw materials where the duty was embedded, because the SSC said that I paid the cost of raw material, there the duty was already embedded. At that time, it did not mean that the SSC was the one who was liable to pay excise duty. He was not liable to pay excise duty. He was paying the cost of the raw material. It was merely the incident of the excise duty that had shifted from manufacturer to the purchaser, which he was paying. And it was not his liability. Thus, the utilized credit under moderate scheme will not get a deduction under section 43B, and therefore this is a very important decision in favor of the department. Now, Kishore Jeevan Das Tanna versus JDI investigation on 132.5. Whether the question to be answered here is whether the High Court could deny the SSE refund of the seized cash on the ground that SSE did not file execution petition under Rule 6647 of Chapter 23 of the Bombay High Court Rules 1980, and petition was not filed within reasonable time, where failure to make the payment was due to the negligence on part of the authorities. Now here, the seized cash was supposed to be refunded to the SSE, but the concerned authorities neglected it, and out of negligence, there was a failure to make the payment, and thereafter, it is being contended here that SSE did not make execution petition, and so he should be denied the refund of the seized cash. Now the facts are like this, that on 25 August 87, SSE has checked into a hotel in New Delhi. Mr. Kishore Jeevan Das Tanna has checked into a hotel in New Delhi, and on that same day, search and seizure operations were carried out in the hotel room, and cash of 5 lakh rupees was found in a polythene bag. When he was confronted, on oath he had claimed having collected this amount from a trader in New Delhi. Now the amount of rupees 4,99,900 was seized. 100 rupees was left with him perhaps for expenses. And an order under section 132.5, as was then applicable, was passed by the first ITO holding that there was contradictions and fabrications in the SSE version and stand on the source of these 5 lakh rupees, and therefore the amount which was seized would be retained till the retention order was passed for the assessment order 1988, for the assessment year 1988-89, till that assessment was finalized, as the estimated tax liability and penalty exceeded the seized amount. Now the SSE had challenged the order on 132.5 before High Court. The High Court partly allowed the writ. The order under challenge was set aside as it was passed without following the principles of natural justice. Liberty was granted to the authorities to pass a fresh order after issuing a show cause notice under Rule 112A. Consequent to the aforesaid liberty and direction, the DCIT issued notice under Rule 112A and thereafter passed an order under Section 132.5. The DCIT informed the SSE that the seized cash need not be retained in the case. Thereafter, the assessment order for assessment year 87-88, read with 147, was passed. Seized cash was not accounted and given credit to the assessment in the assessment order at all. The SSE thereupon moved an application under Section 152, objecting that the assessing officer had not given credit to this 5 lakh rupees as tax paid by him. After having waited for some time, the SSE sent written communication, which was received by the office of the DCIT, and he had sought refund of the seized cash. PCIT Mumbai realized his fault and liability to pay, and he wrote a letter to the DCIT investigation in New Delhi, stating that the seized cash was not transferred to the concerned CIT in Mumbai, and therefore same should be transferred, as the SSE was pressing hard for the refund. The revenue had not placed on record further correspondence and the steps taken. So the SSE filed a writ petition before the High Court, having no other option, which was dismissed first on, for the reason that the appellant should have filed execution petition under Rule 647 before the High Court. Second, that the writ jurisdiction was not meant to confer benefit and enable the litigants to sleep over their rights to derive an advantage for themselves. So the appellant had failed to take the refund despite the favorable order made by the High Court more than a decade back, and that is on 25-3-2008, and therefore does not deserve any relief under the court's discretionary equitable jurisdiction. So on this, Supreme Court has held that the judges had the option to treat the writ petition as an execution application itself, or could have given liberty to the SSC to file an execution. Why take him through the process after such a delayed time? Because it can be this under law of limitation, it can be filed within 12 years. The further writ petitions should be filed within reasonable period, which period had to be considered with reference to the facts of a particular case. Therefore, as courts of equity, courts had to evolve principles of practice and not as a rule of law, not to inquire into belated and stale claims, notwithstanding that no period of limitation was prescribed either by the Constitution or by the Limitation Act. So, the revenue did not dispute the fact that the fund had to be refunded, and they could not dispute it that they had to refund the amount. And considerable delay and failure to make the payment had happened, and it was due to the negligence on the part of the authorities. Now, when liability to pay 4,99,900 was acknowledged by the department and accepted, in that case, why we should delay the relief by directing payment in terms of the order under 61325? So Supreme Court has therefore allowed the appeal. Now, let us do one more last case. Sesha Sai Steels Private Limited versus Assistant Commissioner of Income Tax. The judgment is passed on 4-12-2019. I wanted to deal with another one or two judgments like Shilpa Chaudhary. We have already dealt with that. And I think there was one more judgment. Let's see. 247. Whether the entire sale consideration received by the SSC could not be treated as capital gain and brought to tax on the ground that the SSC's case fell within 247(6) where owner's rights were completely intact, both as to ownership as to possession, even de facto. Now, what are the facts of this case? SSC company entered into agreement to sell, but SSC did not file any return for estimate year 245, and it was rejected later by the AO that the agreement to sell was entered into by the SSC, and subsequently a memo of compromise was also entered into between the parties. Based on this discovery of this fact, notice was issued under section 148. Even in response to the notice, no income tax return was filed. A notice was issued under section 142(1). SSC did not turn up. As a result of which, another notice was issued, but this time again the SSC did not turn up. So a third letter was issued, fixing the case for hearing. And in this response, the letter of the SSC wrote a letter requesting to not pass any order under 144. So SSC wrote a letter and to give him time for 1 month. Since time barring was foremost in the mind of the AO, the matter would have got time barred and 1 month could not be given at that time. So a best judgment assessment order was then passed and entire sale consideration was treated as capital gain and brought to tax. CIT appeal, of course, dismissed the appeal of the SSC. The SSC did not comply, did not give reply. The IDAT agreed with the CIT appeal again and found that on or about the date of the agreement to sell, the condition mentioned in section 247 could not be stated to have been complied with. In that, the very fact that the compromise deed was entered into would show that the obligations under the agreement to sell were not carried out in their true letter and spirit. this High Court also held in favor of revenue. So all are holding in favor of revenue. Hence the SSC filed this appeal. SSC has submitted that if you want to attract 247(5), SSC submitted that section 247(5) was attracted on the facts of this case on a reading of the agreement to sell together with the power of attorney. The alternative argument was that assuming that this argument failed, in any case, this case would fall within the section 247(6) because on this date, there could be said to be a transaction which had the effect of enabling the enjoyment of any immovable property. Then the third submission was that in any event, what was relevant to bringing to tax the capital gain in 2004-05 was whether the compromise deed when rendered could be said to fall within any of the clauses under 247. According to the SSC, this could not be said to be the case as a result of which in any event, there would be no transfer of the capital asset within the meaning of 247. So, finally, it is held in this case that the expression enabling the enjoyment must take color from the earlier expression transferring, so that it could be stated on the facts of the case that a de facto transfer had in fact taken place, making it clear that de facto owner rights stood extinguished. So it was clear that as on date of agreement to sell, the owner's rights were completely intact, both as to owner and to possession, even de facto, so that the section equally could not be said to be attracted. So in that sense, this deals with a case of capital gains. We have another important judgment that has been passed on 22-11-2019, Genpact India. It deals with liability under section 115 QA. Facts are that opening share capital of 25 lakh shares was there. It was held by the sole shareholder. Single shareholder was there, and holding company was Genpact India Investment Mauritius. The SSC company bought back 2,50,000 shares from the sole shareholder in May 2013 at the rate of 32,000 per share for a total consideration of 800 crores. In September 2013, a scheme for arrangement was approved by the High Court. Pursuant thereto, the Genpact bought back another tranche of 7.5 lakh shares at the rate of 35,000 rupees per share, total consideration 2,625 crores. From Genpact India Investment Mauritius. Now, during assessment year 14-15, the details of the tax on distributed profits of domestic companies' payments were given in Schedule DDT, where the details of aforesaid transactions were given, but the liability to pay any tax was denied. They said that there was no liability to pay tax. The SSC submitted that the buyback of shares was done in pursuance of the scheme under Section 139(1) of the Companies Act, and this scheme was approved by the High Court. And in such a manner, the same was not a buyback at all in terms of Section 115 QA. And since it was not a buyback, it could not be taxed. The matter was therefore considered, and an assessment order was passed. 10 additions were made, one of them being liability under Section 115 QA also. The AO held that the provisions of 115 QA were introduced as an anti-avoidance measure and with an intent to widen the tax base also. AO holds that the SSC was liable to pay tax at 20%. So the SSC files a petition, the High Court submitting the order passed by the AO was without jurisdiction because buyback of shares in the instant case was in pursuance of the scheme of arrangement. High Court declined to entertain this petition against the demand raised by the revenue under Section 115 QA. The SSC was granted an opportunity to file an appeal. Hence, this appeal has come before the Supreme Court. Now, the SSC has contended before the Supreme Court that no statutory appeal was provided against the order of 115 QA after it was introduced into the statute book with effect from 1/6/2013. Section 115 QA order could not possibly be equated with an assessment order at all, passed under Section 143, against which an appeal lied under 246A. So the denial of the assessee's liability to be assessed in Section 246A was also confined to his liability to be assessed under Section 143(3) also. And the same had nothing to do with assessee's liability to pay tax under Section 115 QA. So in this case, Supreme Court has held that Section 115 QA stipulates that in case of buyback of shares referred to in the provisions of such section, the company shall be liable to pay additional income tax at 20% on the distributed income. Any determination in that behalf, whether it is regarding quantification of the liability or the question whether such company was liable or not liable to pay tax, could be matters which will be in the ambit of the first postulate referred to above. So similar was the situation with respect to provisions of 246A1A, where again, out of certain situations contemplated, one of them was an order against the assessee, where the assessee denied his liability to be assessed under this Act. This was already mentioned there. So the computation and the extent of the liability was determined under the provisions of Section 115 QA. And such determination under the Act would squarely get covered under said expression. There was no reason why the scope of such expression be restricted and confined to issues arising or touching upon 143 or 144 only. It goes to 115 QA also. The SC therefore rejected the submission advanced by the SSC and held that an appeal would be maintainable against the determination of liability under Section 115 QA. And finally, the Supreme Court holds here that there was no infirmity in the approach adopted by the High Court in refusing to entertain the writ petition. The submission that once the threshold was crossed, despite the preliminary objection being raised by the High Court, ought not to have considered the issue regarding alternate remedy might not be correct. The Supreme Court therefore found no error in the approach of the High Court, and therefore the amount had to be taxed. And with that, we come to the end of this presentation. There are a few more judgments, but we'll be sharing this document with you. You can go through those judgments and certainly update yourself. I've already discussed PCIT versus NRA Iron Steel. It's a good judgment. And I'll also recommend to you this Lakshman Das Khandelwal judgment also. Although it should be very clear to you already. It's regarding 292BB section. And in this it was held that for 292BB to apply, the notice must have emanated from the department. If there is no notice at all, if the assessee has even attended the proceedings, it cannot be said that there was a notice. So 292BB will not protect that proceeding. With that having gone through a discussion of various judgments in the past 2 to 3 years, primarily of the Supreme Court and a few of the high courts also. We recommend that please use NJRS continuously, almost on a daily basis, download the judgments, and therefore, with that, we come to the end of this session. And now, I have the proud privilege. I have the proud privilege of inviting my ADG sir, Shri Vivek Kumar sir, and on the screen you are also seeing my JDIT sir, Shri Suren Mohan, and I would request ADG sir to address the participants of this webinar as a valedictory address and to advise and guide the participants. This would be a valedictory address from our ADG to all our participants of this course. Before I invite sir to give you his advice, I would also like to request participants to give your feedback on Daksh. We are very keen to have your feedback on this course and on all other courses also, but particularly for this course, you must go on Daksh and give your feedback. Please give your feedback even otherwise on other communication channels that we have with you all. So sir is already present with us, as you can see, and I request sir to kindly address the participants. Sir.
Thank you, Arvind Mishra, sir. Dear friends, I hope your engagement with this course, one-day course on case laws, has gone well. In the morning, we had Mr. S.S. Rana, CIT in Delhi. I have recently joined from Delhi. There, Mr. S.S. Rana, during his tenure in the tribunal, has worked very hard on the case laws, and his updates are very frequently received on all the WhatsApp groups in Delhi and subsequently shared on all India basis. We also had Arvind Mishra sir taking us through all the case laws which have been through in the last 2 to 3 years and acquainting us. Dear friends, I would like to have a personal feedback on the way the course had gone, so that we at DTRTI, in our endeavor to impart best knowledge in the best possible manner, is achieved with your help. So dear friends, I would request feedback and comments from you at this juncture.
The participants can unmute themselves and speak. So we'd like to request some of the participants to speak. But we request the participants to kindly come forward and speak about their experience of the course, and how would you like to tell us something about the course and something about what you learned and what you would like it to be in the future also. So the participants are requested to kindly unmute themselves and speak at this juncture. Any of the participants who would like to say something or even otherwise, do say something.